Good evening, everyone. Got something a little different for you this evening, and it is evening. It's like 8:30 here, but this is the only time slot we could make work. And hey, there's pretty much nothing I won't do for the community. Anyone who's seen me wearing stupid hats knows this is the case. And so tonight, I'm happy to be bringing you something, as I say, a little different. Something I've wanted to do for a while, actually, but it's a matter of getting the right people in the right place at the right time. And that's to take a bit of a look at the sort of new user experience in Foreman. I think, as many of us know, it can be a tricky project to get up and running. It's a complex beast that gets its fingers into a lot of different parts of your infrastructure. And that's by design, right? Because it's there to make your life as a sysadmin easier. But life as a sysadmin is often configuring many different systems, and therefore, if you want to make that easier, you have to have something else that controls those systems, and so it can be a bit of a pest to get up and running. And we all know this, but as long-term developers, we kind of get blind to the sharp edges of what it's like to be a new user with Foreman. And recently on our forum, a number of users started getting together and giving each other some first-hand experience and support, which I thought was absolutely fantastic, I have to say. That's the sort of thing I've been trying to build for years, is a sort of self-sustaining culture and community that helps each other out. So when that started happening, I'm like, I'm really sad that you have to do this, but I'm really glad that it's happening. So from my perspective, I wanted to kind of revisit some videos I did a long time ago now. I think it was 1.10, 1.11, where I went through some provisioning. I've done workshops on this, but I don't think we've looked at it in a long time. And so the opportunity was ripe to sit down with someone who's new to Foreman and actually kind of dig into some of the issues they're seeing, and to talk about sort of the concepts and the architecture design that Foreman has in mind most of the time. It's not to say you can't make it fit pretty much anything, thanks to the way we've built it, but definitely some ways are easier than others. And so I'm very happy to welcome Mason, who's agreed to share what he's trying to build. And so I'm very grateful to have you here. So thank you very much for spending some time.
Great. Thanks a lot, Craig.
No, not at all. So I thought we might just start by why don't I give you the mic for a minute, and you just maybe have a little couple of minutes, tell us what it is you're trying to build. Obviously, you don't need to go into any sort of corporate details. We don't want to know that. But just in terms of sort of the architecture that you're trying to build and what it is you're hoping to get out of it.
Sure. Yeah, I can do that. So I also feel the need to do a brief little bit of preamble just to explain why I am such a noob at this, just because it's a little awkward for me to be doing a live video on something like this. So I have a long tech background. I've been in tech for about 20 plus years. Started out with electronics and stuff. Worked for a cable company for 15 years. Initially as a sysadmin, and got pushed into management. Company got purchased. I got pushed into sales. But I started working with this style of managing machines back in about 2003, back before Puppet and everything. It was CF Engine back then. And we were using Puppet when that came out after Luke started up Reductive Labs. Anyway, so did the sysadmin thing for quite a while, but then in about 2006, as I say, got pushed into management, and it's been a long time since I've really had my fingers in this stuff, so I'm getting back into it now and seeing where the tools are at. They've evolved enormously since since I was last using them, so I feel kind of like a total noob, but at the same time, I understand where all this stuff comes from. So anyway, that's my little preamble. In terms of what I'm trying to accomplish, I'm working with a little managed services provider company and trying to change the model, because right now managed services tends to be, you know, we'll install a client on your Windows machine and then we'll just manually do stuff by hand. And it's really labor intensive. So what I'm trying to do is to build so automate the build of some centralized infrastructure that will then in turn allow us to build appliances that go on site to customer locations, And that appliance that's on site there will then manage their local infrastructure. So I know that's a tall order, given that I haven't been in this field for quite some time, but that's the gist of what I'm trying to accomplish.
Fantastic. Can I dig into that a little bit? So obviously I get the concept of the managed centralized infrastructure, because we know what that is, right? That's Foreman.
Yep.
But do you envisage a Foreman server per site, or when you say an appliance, is that something more custom and you just need to spin that up using Foreman and Puppet and whatever else?
Yeah. So the appliance is something that we will build before we deploy. So that'll probably be built locally. And it's a base host OS with a bunch of VMs and containers on it, internal virtual network, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And then what gets deployed out to the client will eventually, not in any sort of near-term release, but eventually we'll be managing a lot of Windows infrastructure at the client end. So right, it's okay. Going so to fill a lot of roles.
Basically, that's not our problem.
No.
So if I'm hearing correctly, then the issues we're looking at are automating. So I heard automating deployment of Foreman.
Yep.
I'm guessing that's a kind of disaster recovery situation.
It is.
I'm hearing provisioning. Potentially yes. On site, or even so when you're doing provisioning, are you looking at it from provisioning at the customer site, or do you provision locally and then ship out?
At this point, it's provision locally and ship out.
That's easier.
I don't imagine we're going to be shipping bare hardware to a customer location and then provisioning from there. No.
Sure. I mean, it doesn't matter either way, right? Wherever the subnet is, you can provision on it, right? But certainly in terms of architecture, that's obviously easier and less for us to deal with this evening. Yes. And then obviously there's some Puppet-related stuff there that you want to just get the basics working there. And then obviously once you've got any configuration manager, you can deploy what you like once you've got, because that's really the core of Foreman, right? It's those two jobs. Let's get some OS on the disk and let's get it into configuration management. And then that's like 80% of our job done, right? That's the 80-20 rule. It's the easiest bit, but it's also the most important bit. And then the other 20% is all the other fun, like DNS records and DHCP and Realm, free IPA, whatever.
Yeah.
So this is great. I know you're interested in Katello in terms of content management for those hosts. So that's cool. And we can look into that if you're having problems with that.
Okay.
And then potentially we could talk a bit about expansions, about things that you might be interested in doing. I know pre-show we talked a little bit about discovery, so that could be something to talk about. It probably makes really good sense just right now for people who are new to Foreman. I know you've probably already seen this, but I'm going to show this just for really new people. I'm going to show this diagram here. Most people who've been in the community for more than about a year probably have seen this diagram at some point. It makes its way into just about every talk. And the idea here is, this is the architecture of Foreman, right? So this is, you've already kind of considered this. I think you already know roughly what you want out of your architecture. But for everybody else, if you're thinking about, if you heard what Mason and I were discussing there and thought, ooh, multiple Foreman servers, let me stop you right there. The idea of Foreman is that it should be a single source of truth, right? And that you should only have one of them, even if you've got multiple data centers. So if you're, so obviously Mason, you're doing like client service type stuff where you want a small number of machines at a client site or something like that. But for other people, it might be a case of multiple data centers, or maybe you're doing multiple tenant systems on a single infrastructure like OpenStack or something like that. So regardless of what you're doing, Foreman wants you to look at it through this lens, which is you have one Foreman. Now, when I say one Foreman, what I mean is one Foreman appliance. Whether they, if you're big enough, you might need to have multiple machines with load balancers and a clustered database and all the rest of it. But conceptually, a single Foreman server, right? And where you need to manage services, that's where you use the thing we call the smart proxy, which even after 8 years, I have not succeeded in getting that name changed. It's a terrible name. It should be just called the Foreman proxy everywhere, and then nobody would be confused. But sadly, for historical reasons, it's called the smart proxy, and that's just what it is. So if you see Foreman proxy, if you see smart proxy anywhere in the literature, those two things are the same. You might also see capsule for various reasons as well, but they're all basically the same thing. It's a small piece of code. You run it where there's a service to be managed. And so in this diagram, you can see we've got one here managing Puppet, and we've got one here managing DNS, and one here doing DHCP and base management controllers, TFTP over here, so on, right? So wherever you have things, you put a smart proxy, and then somewhere you put Foreman and all the proxies towards Foreman. And the reason we do that is so that you can have a consistent API to talk to. And this is particularly important when you think about the jobs that the proxies are doing and how there might be different ways to fulfill those jobs. So if you think about something like DNS, right, the default that we go for is bind, but you might be using power DNS or unbind or MiceMan or InfoBlox or whatever, right? And so the proxy can switch out those backends, those plugins, but present the same API to Foreman, and so Foreman does not need to care. And this is really, really useful. And so this architecture works really well. You can use it to manage sort of very heterogeneous mixed infrastructure. And that's always where we do our best work. I do this all the time at conferences. I will always say the same thing. If you are managing a single thing, apart from physical hardware, which is always complicated, but if you are just doing EC2, or you are just doing OpenStack, or you were just doing Docker, whatever, use the tools that go with that thing, right? They will always be better than what we can provide. The minute you have two or more of these things, which is frankly nearly everybody, then we're really good because we can give you that consistent infrastructure view regardless of what the back end looks like, right? So that's my spiel. That's the kind of the two-minute overview of the Foreman architecture for those who are entirely new and possibly had a different view of how things might go together. So That's what we want to do. That's what it sounds like you're already planning to do. And so what I'm hearing from you is central Foreman, single subnet, potentially two subnets, maybe the provisioning network separate. I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, I have some ideas about that, which might be a topic of discussion here.
Okay.
Like the idea of having a build network, and then once something is built, it gets pushed onto a production network.
That's
so
supported.
Production never touches it.
We can talk about that. That's supported. And then we've also got some content stuff, so Katello, Puppet, etc., and then maybe some discovery and things like that. Where would you like to start?
Well, really what I'm interested in today is for us to get a basic lab set up. So you know what I'm hoping to accomplish down the road, but what I really want today is just to be able to have Foreman up and running, to be able to provision hosts, ideally using discovery on a single subnet, and in a completely standalone sort of lab setup where Foreman is doing DNS, DHCP, TFTP, etc., all on one box.
That's perfect. I will put a disclaimer there. I think the issue of automating Foreman itself should possibly be a back burner issue until you
get
what you want, right?
Okay.
I feel like that's the last thing rather than the first thing. So we shouldn't talk too much about that, partly because you do need to know the end state, right? Partly because it's a real pain, to be honest.
I've found.
Yeah. So I think that might be one to revisit once you're happy with everything else. And that might not be a topic for this evening. But everything else, I think it's worth a go. How far have you got down that road? Where are we starting from?
Well,
switch to your video.
if we switch to my screen, let's see.
I've already done it.
Oh, you've already done it. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I get to control what YouTube sees. So.
You have the power.
I do.
Okay.
I'm a broadcaster.
This is my Foreman installation as it sits right now.
You've closed your screen sharing, so we can't see anything other than your.
Oh, have I really? Right now. Oh, well, that's lovely. I didn't intentionally close it.
Open it up again.
There we go.
Right, so this is my
screen. All better?
You're showing the Hangout right now, so switch to
Another
tab. Here we are. Right.
All good?
Oh, yes.
All right. So, my problem as a new user is that I don't actually know when I'm done setup. So one thing that would be helpful is if you look through what I have and tell me what's missing. And I can tell you what has been done so far. I just don't know what's missing.
Okay. So let's start from basics. I'm presuming you've run the Foreman installer, apparently with the Katello scenario. And so if we were to can we grab a shell and just have a quick look at what's running on the box?
Yeah. Oops, not that window.
Don't show us that. We don't need to see that.
Yeah.
All right. So just give us a PX. Well, I guess PX PSAXF would be great. If that would be fantastic.
And it's
this will probably be a lot. Yep. All right. So we've got Pulp there. Fantastic.
Yep.
We've obviously got Apache. Great. Keep going up a little. Just our Dynflow is running. That's good. Squid as well. Nice. That's just Passenger. That's cool. That's Pulp. Name D. So you've got DNS.
Yep.
Great.
Yeah.
Candlepin.
lots of Foreman.
Yeah. Lots of Postgres connections. Nice. Yep. More Pulp stuff. I see DHCPD there. That's nice. And what else have we got here? So XINIT D, good. So that'll be our TFTP server. Smart Proxy, of course. Puppet is running. We've got Tomcat for various Katello things. This is all looking pretty solid. I'd say that looks like a full install. Obviously, without testing it, it's hard to know for sure. But so far, that's looking pretty good. So let's look at things from the Foreman side then.
Okay.
So,
and again, not that window. Here. Oh, that's what happened. Oh, hold on. Just bear with me for a sec. Do you want to just take me off the screen sharing for a moment?
Yeah, I can do that for a second. Cool. Okay, there we go. Let me know when it's safe to come back to you.
All right. I don't know why that disappeared. And there we go. Oh, I see why. Okay. Yep. Good.
We're back. Okay. Good.
It's because I was being helpful in trying to do full screen, which takes me off a desktop. So,
okay. So let's have a look around here. So why don't we go to all hosts for a start? I'm assuming we only have the one at the moment, but let's have a look.
Okay. So, come on.
So all hosts is really. I appreciate when you've got a full Katello install as a new user. The menu is huge. Right. It's massively confusing. And it's been one of my biggest bugbears. And I'm not saying anything surprising to anyone here who's been around for a while. I really dislike the fact that you have to have Katello installed at the beginning. It is a long-term issue that we've had. And there's historical reasons for it. If you're interested, I'll tell you the details. But essentially, it's the only plugin that must be installed from the beginning. Mainly because it is so complex and touches so many things that trying to set it up afterwards turns out to be a massive headache. But it does have this new user cost that it makes the UI very complicated for someone who's never seen any of this stuff before, which is why I tend to advise go with a sandbox that you don't mind blowing away. Spend it, because the thing is, when you've seen it done enough times, and this is why I try to video it when we can, you can spin up Foreman in like an hour in a sandbox network and play with it, right? And then you get a feel for what base Foreman looks like, and then you can see where the edges are. And when you bring Katello in, you see what's new and which things have come from Katello and which things have not. And whilst that stuff shouldn't matter, I completely agree. It does. You'd like it to be seamless. You'd like it to be obvious. You'd like it to all just work, right? But when something breaks, you need to know where to look and particularly who to bug. And that's usually where it helps to know what came in later. But unfortunately, whereas most plugins, you would add them after you've got something working, right? So Discovery is a great example of this. You can get a base Foreman up and running, and then you can add Discovery to it. You can't do that with Katello. And it kind of bums me out because it does make it very difficult for new people to come in who aren't really used to this.
Gotcha.
Anyway, so it looks like we've got a host. Looks like it's reporting. Which is great. So it seems like we've got Puppet working at some level. If you just hover over the tick next to the name of the host, box, the actual green tick in its name.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, no changes. So, okay, so it looks like it's reporting, which is great to see.
Yeah.
So it looks like our Puppet infrastructure is working just fine, although we can test that further and maybe apply some classes if you'd like. Okay. So this is all looking pretty good to me so far from a configuration management point of view. Let's have a look at the provisioning side of things. So why don't we go into that host or even just click edit over there. Either works.
Okay.
All right. So we've got some information. This looks pretty nice. Click edit.
Yep.
Fantastic. So if you look at, of course, this will be an unmanaged host because it was discovered from a puppet report. So this is an important point for people to realize is that Foreman doesn't mandate that you use any of its features. And so you can do just puppet and just puppet reporting or just puppet ENC or indeed other configuration management, right? Chef, Salt, Ansible, whatever. And you need never touch provisioning if you don't want to. And what will happen is that as hosts check in with puppet, I'm going to use Puppet as a shorthand here, but whatever you want. And yeah, as hosts check in with Puppet, as reports are sent to Foreman, if it doesn't match them to a host, by default, it will create a host to hold those reports, which is where this has come from, right? Which is why a lot of these fields are blank and why in the top right you have a button marked Manage Host, which is...
Great. I won't, but because that's been one of the big questions is, do you use Foreman to manage Foreman or not?
You can. It doesn't really make any difference for this host, but you can imagine if you then opened up the rest of your infrastructure to start sending Puppet reports in, they'd all be unmanaged hosts initially, right? Mm-hmm. And then you might choose to then manage some or all of them depending on how it makes sense. Clearly, you cannot rebuild Foreman without Foreman once you've got your provisioning working because Foreman's providing the kickstart files, right? But does it make sense to have the thing managed? Well, at least it would be you'd know it was in DNS and you'd know it was in DHCP and that its IP was reserved and all the rest of it. In reality, I think it's a bit 6 2/3, really. You can, but it doesn't really do a lot unless you're going to use it to build another Foreman, which can then take over and shut down the old one or something like that. Then it gets, you can do crazy stuff like that. But largely, there's not a great deal of value to it. But if you just want to be consistent across the board, then there's no reason not to as well.
Oh, okay. I think I was seeing in the forum somewhere that people were saying, do not put your Foreman server under management because it doesn't make sense for it to be managing itself. But I'm like, well, it was built with Puppet, so I would think you would continue.
Well, Puppet is irrelevant to this discussion. When we say a managed host, we're talking specifically about the provisioning side of things. It's not a great name in that respect, I appreciate. Because you still have a Puppet classes tab there, right?
Yeah, I do.
Exactly. So actually, unmanaged in this case is talking about the hardware itself rather than the OS.
Oh.
That's really what we're talking about. I appreciate looking at it through a fresh pair of eyes. I can see how that would be confusing. Again, it's one of those things that we're just used to, right? We've been doing this a long time. It's not talking so much about the OS as the physical hardware or the VM, right? And in the VM, that makes less sense because you just blow it away and build a new one, right? But in terms of physical hardware, yeah, it's like, is the chassis managed? Because you might want to re-image that, right? You might want to put a different OS on it or partition the disk a different way or whatever.
Yeah.
And then that's when you'll want to reboot it into an installer and deploy something different, right? And so that's what we're talking about with managed here. I'm loath to make you click that button without having checked the rest of the thing, but it would probably work fine. Let's check.
Okay.
Go to the infrastructure tab, if you would.
Okay.
And if we go, let's start at the top. Let's go to smart proxies. Now, I'm pretty confident that we'll see something sane here because we already know it's the one running. Right, so we've got a proxy and it's got a whole ton of features. You probably need to click on it in order to get it to show all of them. Oh, yeah, you can hover it. So these are all things we expect. Oh, you got OpenSCAP in there. Oh, yeah, it comes. Does that come with Katello? I think it does.
No, I had...
You added that.
I had to turn it on anyway.
I can't remember. There's so many, but we got 90 plus plugins, right?
Yeah.
And you got Discovery in there as well. Wait, that has a smart proxy feature now? That never needed one before.
It does.
Fantastic. All right. Anyway, the things I care about.
That's something new every day, eh?
Oh, I love this. I love our community. Yeah. I consider it a mark of honor that I can't keep up with the forum anymore.
Oh, good.
We get through 40,000 emails a month out of that thing.
Holy.
Well, it's because quite a lot of people use the mailing list mode, which emails them everything, and it's just like, don't do
that. Right.
Anyway, DHCP, DNS, TFTP, those are the ones that are going to matter for provisioning. And then also, obviously, pulp and things matter for Katello-specific content. But specifically for can I deploy an OS at some level? Absolutely. DNS, DHCP, TFTP, those are the ones that matter. So we have those. That's good. Let's go and have a look at the domains next.
Okay. Domains.
Okay, so we have a domain. Great. Click on that if you would.
Okay.
We're looking for something specific here. Right, so it has a DNS proxy. So Foreman splits up how it handles A records and PTR records. So you can have a proxy set for the subnet and not the domain, in which case you'll get PTR records and not A records, right? And vice versa is true as well. So by having this set here, we know we're gonna get A records out of this.
Okay.
If you create foo.ftlcomputing.ca, we should see that coming up in the DNS because this domain has a DNS proxy set. So that's good. Let's have a look at the subnet.
And so just a quick thing about that. So the DNS proxy, in this case, we're an all-in-one server where the proxy is running on the same host as Foreman. And so when you're talking about, I didn't quite follow. So when a forward record is created, you can do either a forward or
so you can have a mix. So the idea is that when you, we'll see this in a minute, when you create a host, you will select a domain and a subnet for it. So let's say we go back to my diagram here. Let me switch to me for a sec. So I'll still get it open. Yeah. So if we're here at Foreman, then you could have, you can see actually in this image, we've got DNS here and we've also got DNS here as well. And so I could have domain one over here and domain two over here, and maybe only, I could even have domain three here, which is DHCP, but it has no DNS, right? So why would I set DNS proxy for that domain? And so the domain exists because I want to, I'll need to assign a fully qualified domain name to this host, but it won't try and create an A record. So there's a set of orchestration steps when you create a host, and which orchestration steps will be executed and which ones will be skipped depends on what features are available on the proxies, right? And so Foreman will go through it and go, okay, I'm going to create DNS records. Do I have a domain proxy? Yes. Okay. Create me an A record. Do I have a subnet proxy? Okay. Yes. Create me a PTR record. Do I have a DHCP proxy on this subnet? Okay. Can I have an IP address, please? And so on and so forth. Right? So the orchestration depends on what features are available.
So just a potential scenario, then you've got multiple subnets and you're managing with a smart proxy at the edge there, but you have a central DNS server. And so maybe you're relying on DNS dynamic update or something like that in order to push your record back to the central DNS server?
Probably doable. As a relayed DNS stuff is not stuff I've played with much. But equally, I can't see why that couldn't be made to work, although I have no doubt someone's going to shout at me for saying that.
I'm just trying to think of when you wouldn't run a DNS proxy at the edge.
Right, exactly. But either way, Foreman can either create it or not, right? And if you say then it won't do it. So, let's go back to your... You don't need to switch to me, by the way. I can do that in the Hangout.
Okay.
You can just stay here. Okay, so let's have a look at the subnet. I mean, this is all looking pretty good so far. And then I'm going to ask John... I'm going to give John a heads up because I'm going to ask him for some input in a minute. So let's have a look at this subnet, shall we?
Okay.
So there'll be a lot more fields here, but the main thing is if we go to the proxies tab. So again, we see that we've got what we expect, which is that there's a TFTP proxy, a DNS proxy. There's a few more fields here, but the reverse DNS proxy is what we're talking about in terms of PTR records. TFTP proxy is what it sounds like. It needs to know where to go and write the records for Pixie. And DHCP proxy obviously is where it's going to go and ask for IP addresses and write its reservations. So again, if you don't have those set, then it won't try and do those things. And then potentially things can not work the way you anticipated because they're not there. And this is one of the fundamental problems we have when trying to troubleshoot things with people in IRC is there's just a lot to look through. And when someone says comes into IRC and says provisioning's not working, and we're like, try this list of 10 things.
Yes. And so I assume that these should also be set given I want to do discovery?
There's no reason not to set them right now.
Okay.
I wouldn't... No, don't set the template proxy just now. That has interesting consequences. So.
Okay.
Templates is a great plugin. I wrote that one as well. So clearly I think so. Again, not my baby anymore. Andrew's taken a fantastic ownership of that and done great things with it. It was my concept originally. But what it does is it changes the workflow. So most things go through the proxy, but templates are the one thing that don't by default. So if you think about a machine that's booting up in a secondary data center, for example, so it's going to boot up, it's going to get DNS, DHCP, Pixie, it's all going to come from its local proxy, right? But when it gets as far as Kickstart and says, hey, I want my Kickstart, that's a direct call to Foreman by default. Mm-hmm. And the URL is actually given in the Pixie file. If that can't work, that's where the template proxy makes sense.
Right.
But if you're doing it all one subnet, then there's no reason to set it. You're just complicating. You're adding more layers in, right?
Yeah.
Because what's actually happening is that you're calling to the proxy, which in real time then makes the call to Foreman and then literally does a regex where it takes out Foreman's URL and replaces it with its own before passing it back to the client.
Got it. I will want this in my future implementation, but I do not right now.
Get things working without and then try enabling it and seeing how that changes the workflow.
Got it.
Discovery, we're not going to play with just now, so fine. Yeah. Okay, so this is all looking great. So let's go ahead and what how should we do this? Do you have some hardware that you want to play with?
I do, yeah.
We've got a Mac, got a machine ready. Is it, what are we talking, is it a VM? Is it a physical?
It's a physical box. Okay. It's great. It's set up to Pixie boot, so.
Brilliant. All right, let's do that then. So let's go to hosts, new host.
Okay. Create host.
Yeah, create host. Sorry, it used to be new host many years ago. Yep. okay, so what do we got here? This is all looking fine. So organization location, you should probably set. You can change the name if you want. There's a generator there, obviously. This is fine. Host group, you won't really have any yet. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Nope. That.
There we go. So host groups, just for people who don't know, host groups function, they kind of two things at once. Largely, they act as a group of defaults. And so you can specify a whole bunch of stuff in your host group to save you filling in the boxes here. Mm-hmm. And when you select a host group, it'll fill in all the appropriate fields for you. This is great. mm-hmm. The one bit that's not true, but the thing is you can override it, right? So you can apply a host group and then you can go back and go, this is all great apart from this one field that I want to be different. And that's totally fine. Foreman won't enforce the host group requirements. They just use it as a collection of defaults that you can then override at a lower level. However, there is one exception to that, and that's that you can store puppet classes in a host group and use it as a kind of roles and profiles approach, going right back to Craig Dunn's thing from many years ago. And so the idea is you can store a whole bunch of puppet classes within a set of nested host groups, then you can apply those host groups. And you can't take a class out of a host group. You can't override it and say, I don't want that one in here. Because host groups, the way Puppet's concepts work is they're always additive. And so you can add more classes specifically to a host, but you can't say, I want this everything in this host group except that one class. And host groups will be applied every half an hour, right, or whatever your runtime is. So unlike most things in a host group, which will be applied once at creation time, and only then if you don't override them, but even then you can go and change them later, and it won't ever check. But what's in the Puppet section or the configuration management section is obviously going to get applied every time the configuration management runs.
Yeah. So one thing that this discussion is helpful for me, and I'm just going to say it because I think it might be for other new people, mm-hmm. is that it's not really clear to me. Like I'm familiar with Puppet concepts. You know, you've got your regular runtime, you've got this class inheritance, all this stuff, mm-hmm. but I don't really know where Foreman leaves off and Puppet begins and
I can show you.
Okay. So but I'm just bringing that up because what you're talking about.
Very good point. And I can, there's actually a very well-defined edge between the two, but it is frequently lost. I hear you. And I have had many a day in IRC where I've had to define the edge for people and then tell them to go and get help in Hash Puppet.
Gotcha. So
we'll come to that in a minute, but let's do this first. Let's have a Puppet environment.
I don't have one.
Okay, don't worry about it. So we might need one. It might not save without, but we'll see. So to be clear, lifecycle environment, content view, content source, these come from Katello. These are Katello's concepts of how you promote content through how you would test it and make sure that it's working. And also how you answer questions like, can I build a production server as it was 6 months ago? Mm-hmm. Because for most people, actually, the answer to that is no. Because the mirrors have changed, right? And that's why something like Katello has value on top of things like errata management and so on. But just the ability to say, I can definitely rebuild the thing that works.
Yes.
Because we have all the RPMs right here in this particular version of this content view. That's got huge value to people, right? That's why Katello is so popular. But it adds all these extra fields. So anyway, let's add a Puppet Master, Puppet CA. Don't worry too much about the OpenSCAP proxy for now.
Yep.
Okay, operating system. This may fail without a Puppet environment, but if it does, we'll fix it. Top tab.
Oh, there we are. Thank you. Oh,
yeah. No, it's so there are, without plugins, there are 71 fields in this form. It's just terrible. And we have some ideas in the coming time to try and simplify things and be more opinionated. Doesn't matter which one of these you pick, I don't think.
Yeah, just a quick question about this. This one comes because it's discovered.
Yeah.
Do I have to manage these separately in Puppet or?
Not in Puppet. So Centos.
In Foreman.
7 has been a little pain in our necks because of the minor versioning, and it broke a lot of things, and we had a lot of fun with that because of the way we architected things over the years. Right. Just go with that one for now, and we'll just see what needs. This is a debugging session, right? It might not work. We'll see.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. So media. Let's go for an upstream media. That's great.
Okay, so I got another question. I'm always full of questions.
Yeah, full this would be a very boring video without questions.
Right, okay. So I found it really strange when I was doing the setup that I'm installing a Katello instance. I'm replicating all these repositories locally. But then when it comes to setting media, I'm picking a public mirror. And I'm like,
right. So that's not coming from Katello. So John will probably be better able to answer this than me. But basically what happens here is once you've, on that first tab, once you've set your lifecycle environments and all your content views, then this gets auto-populated by Katello.
Okay.
So if you synced some content, then we can try it.
and give it a go. I have. And so then...
So John, what are we missing here? Why are we not getting like the Katello... Oh, syncs content, media selection, right above it.
Oh, I can't choose that.
Oh, okay. What's broken, John?
Sorry, I'm switching between the windows because I mean...
So we're trying to get the synced content section of the media selection to work. We've got... Can you go back to the host tab, Mason?
Yeah, sure.
So I think
have you synced any Kickstart repositories?
I have, or at least I believe I have.
Let's go have a look. So let's go for a new tab and head to some of your content. I guess what I don't know.
Do you want me to bring up an like new tab or just?
Yeah, keep that form open because we wanna play with that.
Okay.
But
all right, so I'll just.
Yeah, that seems good. Okay. So where should we look to check things, John?
So sync status?
Why don't you go to products? Let's take a look there, see what products you have.
And so that might be an issue.
Are we in the F2L org with the other?
No, we're in the any org because I don't.
No, but in the host form you selected F2L,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying is the Foreman host doesn't get populated in with the FTL org.
And I can show you how to change that.
I know how to change it. It was just during the automation, there was no obvious way of doing that. So
yeah, this is going to be slightly better soon, I think, because we're basically forcing this feature for everybody instead of making it an option. That will help us to simplify some of the code and so on. So,
okay.
But anyway.
All right. So John, here's products.
Okay, and you're trying to do Centos 7?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, why don't you go into there?
You're muted.
Sorry, I see Greg's, or I see the documentation screen, so I'm
John, you probably clicked on me. If you look in your Hangout, have I got a white box around my window?
Oh, there we go. I just clicked on
me. There we go.
Okay.
So if you click on Mason, you'll get his screen.
Just don't click too hard. I bruise easy.
I will try.
Okay.
Try the OS. I'm not like as familiar. I haven't done the Kickstart repositories in a while, but I might have to ask someone about this. Let me ask someone.
Okay. While you're doing that, why don't we talk a little bit about Puppet and John can jump back in once he's checked? Because I'm conscious that we have about 20 minutes left and we haven't actually done very much.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But it's great fun. Well, I can run a little long if you can. I'm not too worried.
Yeah, I'm actually good today. So
all right. So let's go for the center. The thing is, there's only so long people will watch this kind of thing. So
yes, that's
so
true.
So you know, if it's going to be useful to other people, we kind of have to make
it move it along.
Anyway, let's go down a bit. So let's come down here to keep going down. So root password. Just to be clear to people, that's not. So what that is what are we going to put in the Kickstart to tell the installed machine what its root password is.
Yeah.
Right. And it will have a default in the global settings, so you don't have to set it here if you don't want to, but you can. Largely speaking, this is an irrelevant field. It really annoys me that it's mandatory. That's why there's a global setting, just to get past that.
I've probably not got the global set because whenever I try this, it doesn't let me go without putting something in.
Put something in then. We can set it later. The reason it annoys me is because most people are going to use SSH keys, right? And I don't know about you, but I put my SSH key in my template. That it gets deployed automatically and I can just SSH to the thing, which is what you want. But anyway, hit resolve and let's check we have some templates. Okay, we have, so this is good. And if you let's just pick a couple of these to have a look. So take the Pixie Linux template, right click that link and open it in a new tab. Well, I don't know if you right click, you're clearly on a Mac, but anyway. but let's open that and just have a quick look at it. So this is for people who don't know too much about format provisioning. So the idea is that we're going to write some files and we are going to check that those files are getting written. So come down a bit. So if you now hit preview, there's a lot here. And then take the drop down. Oh, you've not got any managed hosts, so we can't preview. Right. This is one of the downsides of the previews. Until you've got at least one managed host, then there's nothing to preview with, right? Because we can't preview with a host we haven't created yet.
Right.
It's not been saved to the database, right? But anyway, so go back to input. It doesn't matter. Okay, we're going to get someone else in to talk about Kickstart repos in a minute. So go down. Scroll past all this. This is all ERB. So if you don't like Ruby, never go into Foreman's templating. Mm-hmm. but here's the bit that looks like Pixie, right? And so you've got a timeout. You've got a template name, which is just a menu label. And then here's the fun bit, right? Init RD and kernel, and then kickstart equals Foreman URL provision. And so what we'll do is we'll see when we get the provisioning files written to disk, we'll check the TFTP proxy, and that we should see a file that looks remarkably like this, only with a much longer append line.
Right.
And that will be that template getting written to disk. So that's one example. Okay, so you can close this tab.
Okay.
Oop. And we'll just do one more. Let's have a look at the provisioning template, Kickstart default. Hey, Partha.
Hey, can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can. Yep. Thank you for joining us at short notice. We'll come back to you in just a sec. So this is a huge file. You can see the size of the scroll bar. and there's a lot of options in there. But I just want to focus on this top bit. You can see there's a whole ton of options here. And so this is a really useful feature of Foreman, is that you can have one template, but it's a template, right? That's the key word here.
Yep.
And that you can customize that template and have it fulfill different roles based on parameters that you put in the host. So you can see, for example, we have enable Puppet Labs PC1 repo right at the bottom there, which defaults to false. So if you want the very latest version of Puppet, you can put enable Puppet Labs PC1 repo true into the host parameters. And when this is rendered, it will pick that up and change the rendered version of the template. And so that's super powerful, right? Is that you can have potentially parameters set at the host group level, which are then going to be applied to all hosts in that host group, which then customize the template, right? So you can say, build me a new host in this host group, and everything is correct, including the customizations to the template.
Okay.
Very powerful. And there's so much more to templates that people never discover. But well, that's for another day. Okay, so close this down. This looks like these are the right files. I'm pretty happy with this.
Yeah. Okay.
So, Partha, we're short on time, but really quickly, can you help us understand? Could you go to the operating system tab on that new host?
On the new host, yeah.
Yeah, please. So we've got some synced content. As far as we can see, we've got the CentOS repo. It's got like a 10,000 packages in there, and we're trying to understand why it won't let us select it.
Okay, I can't see the screen yet. It's still showing me the Foreman.
You need to click on Mason's
picture
in the Hangout, and that should make him full screen.
I see.
Hangout debugging session as well.
New to this. Okay.
That's cool.
So it won't let you select synced content. That's the problem.
Yep.
Yeah.
It says there's no operating system. Okay.
We haven't selected one. We should probably select the operating system that it's been synced for, right?
Well, that's odd because I did have that option a moment ago.
Okay, let's just go back to the first.
Oh, tab. I think it's something to do with my org.
Okay.
If I select, see now I can.
Okay. So let's select that.
Yeah.
And then.
So you need. Okay. You won't see this synced. So how did you create the operating system?
How did I create it?
That's the automatically discovered one from Fax. Try the other one.
Oh.
Does it work now? No, it still won't work now. Okay.
No, the question is, did you actually sync? Did you sync the CentOS?
Okay. I did. Yeah. So this is if I go into products, CentOS.
Okay, that was the screen. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I've
click on the OS 64. Let's see if there's a bootable distribution there. You just had the repo. Oh yeah, come down. See, let's check the distribution information. It is bootable. Okay. That last
one. Oh, this here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That is what should create you the operating system.
Oh, well, we didn't select a lifecycle environment on the first tab this time, did we? Didn't we miss that step?
Yeah, you need all the five things, like lifecycle environment, content source, content view, operating system, and architecture.
And
yeah, it's going to reset it, unfortunately. Those two fields should always be the first ones. Yeah this is one of the things I wanted to point out, is that they have such a big effect on what's available to all the other fields.
That makes sense, yeah.
You know, it has to be
okay. So,
it's gone. Right. Okay, so our OS is presumably not in the organization then. One of these fields is wrong. has not got the OS in it.
Yeah.
Hold on. When you went to content view and when you went to content and products.
Yeah.
You chosen FTL as the org. Okay.
Yeah.
You probably want FTL as the org here also in the your kickstart post. Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead
about
of
that.
Oh. Okay.
Can we just open a new tab and look at the operating systems? It's under, I think, infrastructure.
Sure. It's
configure me. Oh, hosts probably actually. Hosts. Even I get lost. Here we go. There it is.
Yeah. Where? Oh, there we are.
Oh, yeah. Open that in a new tab.
Oops. Apparently, I'm opening it in the same tab.
Okay, so let's have a look at the Centos 7 OS.
Just this one, okay?
Yeah. I think that's the one we're working with. So, oh, wait, no, operating systems don't have taxonomies.
They don't have taxonomies. But, so, when go back to the create host page that you had, just change it from any organization to FTL.
Up here?
At the top. Yeah. Yeah.
Guessing it's not getting the org from here. So come down, change the lifecycle environment and all that.
Okay, I got to do this first.
Yeah.
And then lifecycle. Should I be choosing one of these or just use the library for now?
Yeah. Let's start with the library.
Start with library?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do defaults again or choose the one that I've created?
That one, I think, yeah.
Okay. And okay.
Now go to operating systems.
Yeah.
Okay.
Architecture.
You can see why you use the host group for this, right? Top one.
Yeah, it's a very.
There we go. Yes.
Now it works. So what was the magic combination?
It was being in the right organization, I think, was the key thing.
Up here.
I don't know why that should matter when it should work as an admin anyway. But
okay.
Before we go any further, let's go back. Thank you, Partha. Let's see if we can get this done. So go back to the host tab. We just need to select the puppet master for the host.
Tab. Yeah. Okay. Let's
finish that off before we move forward. Again, I hope it won't bit shadows for the puppet environment. Right. So that's good. This tab's done. Let's go back to our operating system tab. Just check we didn't miss any steps there.
Partition table.
Yeah, we still want the partition table. Keep going down, go down, go down, go down. Hit resolve.
I'll have to put something in here.
Anything you like here. Doesn't really matter, right? Resolve. We've got templates. Great. Let's go to interfaces. This is where you need a little bit of paper with a MAC address on it.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a... yeah.
The MAC address.
Yes.
Oh,
you can put anything you like here. We may not actually boot the thing. We're running.
Yeah, that's what it's looking like.
Yeah, just put something in here, and we'll just check that the in principle that it would boot, right? fine. And so this is probably ETH 0. This can you can leave that blank. It's fine. We have no domains. That's interesting. I was not expecting that.
Yeah, I think we have a domain, but it might not be associated with the org properly.
Right, that's most likely true. So again, you can open that in another tab, and we can fix that real quick.
Okay.
I know, I know.
Locations
and orgs. Everybody has a love-hate relationship with them. Like, they're totally necessary for the feature set that we have, but do they cause problems sometimes.
So maybe I need to be setting it here?
No, it's if you open domains in a new the domains bit in a new tab.
Yeah,
that one. Open that in a new tab, and then or this tab, I guess.
But that's what I'm saying is.
Oh, I see what you mean. Right, yeah, if you. No, yeah, no, it's this one that's wrong. Change FTL to any. Because it's the domains and that as well, yeah. Boom, there we go. Yeah, I know, it's horrendous, right? It's just, once you get the concepts behind it, it becomes quite okay, but yeah, it's a horrible mess. This is going to get improved in the future, I think even in the next version, because we're enabling this feature for everyone. Like, you cannot have something that's not in an organization anymore.
Right.
And everyone will get a single organization out of the box, so it'll all just work.
Okay. Yeah,
but normally what happens is, if you don't need this stuff, you turn it off, right?
Anyway, yeah, because we're doing a beginner video, it's like, this is the sort of thing that stumps you.
Absolutely, you're like, well, which is
created the domain. Where the hell's the domain?
Right, and I will show you a little trick in a minute. But go to locations and organizations, just add it to both. And we'll need to do the same for the subnet as well. So you can save that.
Okay.
I'll show you a little trick in a minute that can be very useful when working with organizations and locations as well, which is the fix mismatches button.
Okay.
All
right.
So yeah, location, same thing here.
One's good.
Right, but the subnet belongs to domain, so because we had no domains, we couldn't find anything. Right, okay, that looks good. Now, just before we go any further, if you go to, I think it's might be either configure, one of these menus has what I'm looking for, so just mouse over them slowly. I can never. Oh no, I know where it is. Go to organizations at the top. Go to your drop down on the menu bar, and go to manage. So there's a button here marked mismatches report. Which can be, so there's nothing mismatched at the moment, but if you ever end up in a situation where things are looking weird, this is a good thing to click on, because it will tell you where you've got a host in organization A, which auto detected that it had a subnet, but that subnet's not in organization A. Stuff like that, it will pick it up and offer to try and fix it.
Okay.
So this is fine. Anyway, that host is obviously your Foreman server. Don't worry about that. Right. Okay. Let's go back to our new host form and see if we can finish filling this. We'll get there, right?
Are you having fun yet, Greg?
I'm having a great time.
Oh, good.
Because this is a remote. So close that and then open it again. Hopefully it'll refresh the modal and we can actually get it to detect the domain properly. Is it going to work this time? No. We have to reload this.
New domains.
Try adding a new interface.
I probably have to go to the location again, don't I?
In theory, no, but maybe. I don't think that's going to make. Yeah, I knew that was going to happen. So one of the things that we want to do that's just taking a long time is to implement a wizard here where you can like save state halfway through the process.
Oh, yes.
Which would make so much sense. But then again,
especially since I don't have a host group, so I'm going to get good at clicking.
Right, exactly. You do this like twice and you're done. You'll know all the fields forever. but it is a pain in the neck. But it's like I said at the start, there's so many moving pieces. And particularly, this is why I'm like, I would really love it if we could add Katello to an existing Foreman install, because you could drop about 30% of the fields here by not having Katello and then add it later. Top one. There we go. See, it gets pretty quick once you know it, right? It gets pretty snappy. And our interfaces, root password. No. We should set that default.
We're back here.
Right, so let's edit that. And hola, we can choose a domain.
Hey!
Progress.
There we go.
There we go. So look what's happened there. So already in the background, Foreman has reached out to your proxy and said, give me an IP address that's not in use. And it has. I'll talk very quickly about these flags. So one thing we mentioned early on is about having a separate build network. So you can see here we have primary and provision as two flags. So when you're ready to look into that, for now keep it in one place. When you're ready to look into that, you can obviously add a secondary NIC, a second NIC. You can add as many NICs as you like, but primary and provision can only be on one each. In fact, if you click OK, you'll see it's got those two flags next to it up there. And so you can click that for a different interface and it will move the flag for you, right? So you don't have to go into the edit page just to change it.
So you manually
mark one as provisioning and you mark another one as primary. What's the difference? Oh. I'll tell you. Primary is used for anything to do with the fully qualified domain name. Mm-hmm. So anytime you want to generate a puppet certificate or a token for free IPA or whatever, anytime you need the name of the host, like what is the identity of the host, we use the primary NIC to generate that. Anytime we need to talk to the TFTP server specifically, because it's the only one that actually is specific to this process, that's where the provisioning NIC comes in. So only the provisioning NIC will have TFTP orchestration because it's the only one that actually matters. Every NIC wants DHCP and DNS and things like that, right? But things like IPA tokens and puppet certificates only really concern the identity of the host, so that comes from the primary, and TFTP comes with the provisioning. So that's how you would do it. You have a NIC with, you have a machine with two server, with two NICs, and you configure them both. And you say, this one's on the build network, this one's on the production network. And you know, if you want to go and disconnect one of them after it's built or whatever as an extra air gap security, fine. But in terms of performance concepts, that's how we do it. We're not great at VLANs. It's something I'd like to be better at. Switches are not first-class citizens in Foreman in any way. But so having a single NIC that you move between VLANs is not so easy to do.
Yeah, because that's what I'm planning to do. So,
but equally, if you can handle dealing with the VLANs itself, we can tag, we can write down information. If you go back into edit, actually, it might be under the subnet page, actually, so don't worry about it right now. But you can definitely mark subnets with VLANs. It doesn't really do a lot, but at least you can store the information. and so you can have some progress there. Okay. Anyway, right, Puppet classes. Let's have a look at those. I don't think you have any, so this will
I
be
don't.
Empty. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. And the last two tabs are not particularly valuable either. Or we'll have a quick look at them. So parameters are generally things that go into Puppet classes, but as discussed, they can also go into templates as well. So you could, for example, add the one of the parameters we were talking about here about parameters. Enabling things, right? So you could put, you know, enable Puppet Labs PC1 repo true, and it would do that, right?
Okay.
So don't need to worry about that. You can remove it because it's empty.
Yep.
And then additional information, very, very quickly, just to cover it. It's pretty self-explanatory, but you know, who owns it? What's the hardware model, if you care? It will auto-detect it when it gets Puppet reports.
Yeah.
It. All that kind of thing. Right. So hit now. Before you hit save, go back to the shell on the Foreman server.
Okay.
I'll go away from you for a sec.
No, I'm good.
You're good? Okay, I'll come back.
Yep.
Okay. So what I want you to do is just, I guess this is a Red Hat type machine, so it'll be in varlib tftp boot. Have a look in that directory.
Varlib.
Yeah, tftp boot, there it is. Memory has not failed me. Have a look in the pxclinux.cfg directory. Don't cd, just ls it.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and then also have a look at the boot directory as well. Have a look in there. Fabulous. Nothing. Right. Go and hit save on that host.
Okay. Oops.
See?
It's okay.
Hopefully this will work. Fingers crossed. We've been at the actual provisioning part of this for about half an hour, right? So it's actually pretty reasonable.
Okay,
we'll need to fix that. We can fix that very easily, though, fortunately, although we'll probably have to do the whole form again. So let's go to grab yourself a new tab and go to configure environments.
Okay, where are configure environments? Yep.
And then create a Puppet environment. Call it production.
Okay.
And put it in the production.
Oh, right, yep. Oh, we've called it the whole...
Yeah, yeah. Trust me on this, because that's the default for Puppet. If you don't specify an environment, that's what it calls it. So by... No, lowercase. You were right. That's just what Puppet does. If you say module install NTP or whatever and don't specify anything else, you'll get an environment called production.
Okay.
It's safer that way. And did you do the locations and organizations?
I did, yeah. Okay. Has already been taken.
Really?
So I probably have to import it then.
Oh, wait a minute. Is it, are we in, do we need to be in any org, any location, and just check?
I don't know. Do you want me to try this?
Right, you can try it.
Okay.
We'll see if it actually detects some. Yeah, okay. Try changing your location to any. Just to see. If it's already been taken, there it is.
There it is.
See, that's the taxonomies catching us again. Sorry, taxonomies is a shorthand we use because organizations and locations are the same thing in the code. They're just two-dimensional. So we call them taxonomies. So go into production and make sure it's assigned to the organizational location for this host. There we go. And there we go. So we did have an environment. We just couldn't assign it. And what do you want to bet that we have to fill in the whole form again?
I am going to bet good money on that.
So let's go find out.
Create host.
Oh, you're going to do it anyway. You're just going to jump the gun.
Oh, yeah. Well, we can try.
It won't let you. It won't let
you.
Nope. Reload.
Reload.
Fun time.
Now we're Bet Hobson.
I that name generator is very, very random. I prefer words rather than names. Names weird me out.
Yeah.
I prefer to have like unmanned battery or something.
Sure. Yeah, hey, look, we got an environment.
Yay, we're getting there. You see, as I say, once you've been through this process once, Everything mm-hmm. works, but there's so much that can go wrong the first time.
Yes,
it's a nightmare. I completely agree.
Not that one. That one. Yeah. So many gotchas.
Oh, for sure. And this is, you know, we're 10 years old this year, right? And still, we're still trying to make this better, because it is just horrible. It's the sort of the reason that our justification, and it is a total justification. It's not a good reason, uh-huh. but the justification is that you only have to do it once. Once you've got it sorted and you save all that into a host group, and then you can deploy any number of machines you like, within like three clicks.
Yeah.
And then it all starts to make sense, right? But that doesn't help the new user experience, and we know that.
So glad to hear it.
Yeah, but it's not an easy problem to solve. These things are all here for a reason.
Yes.
And so, yes, there is an argument about being more opinionated and yada, yada, yada. But okay, let's try and save that then, shall we?
All right.
Now, something went wrong on the operating system tab, so let's see what it didn't like there.
Oh, come on.
At least it doesn't reset the form here.
Yes.
Try that one. Let's see if it complains about anything else.
Go away.
It's blank. Oh, it's defaulted.
No!
It's defaulted.
Not again.
No, it's the synced content field.
No, I know, but it was grayed out. I can't select it again.
Oh, go back to the host.
Presumably because I'm in any org, any location.
Wait. Hang on. If that's true, that's really weird. Go to the host tab. Is that in the right place?
Yeah.
That is. No, it's the lifecycle environment that's missing.
Oh. But I
you, put what that context in. You are in should not matter to this. Because it's what the context that the host is in that should matter. But why those fields got blanked, I don't know.
I don't know either. Okay, so that's good.
Question one: bug to send to the Katello developers.
There we go.
we've had that issue for a while now.
Okay, you know about it. Good. Okay. Nice.
Here we go. Password. We're submitting.
Oh, password.
No, come on.
We'll set that default before we go.
Yes.
I reckon we can go for another 15 minutes. We've got to talk about Puppy yet. Okay.
Oh!
See, it's done it again. This is why you have to do everything at once. Don't mess it up. Go back to the first page.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
I reset that?
Yeah. No, that's why I said don't forget the password. I know, right? It's so annoying. And again, I will reiterate, if people who are watching this,
yes,
I love my Katello friends, but start with a plain Foreman sandbox that you can blow away and then rebuild it with Katello once you've got everything else happy. And I'm sure you guys would agree, right? This is a good workflow.
Yeah. Okay, so we're good to submit?
Let's check everything else. Before we press it and mess it up again,
yeah.
The interface is still correct? Yes, it's got an IP address, good, and we don't care about the last three. Good.
Yeah.
Save it.
Okay.
Come on.
Fingers and...
Oh, hey,
that looks broken.
You will only see that for a few seconds, but you can see what it's doing.
Mm-hmm. Yay! Successful.
Right, so what have we got here? Let's just take stock for a second. We've got a very similar page to what we had with the other host, but there's a lot more detail here now, mm-hmm. and we know a lot more about this host. And if you were to go to Edios, I'm not saying you should, then you would be able to obviously change any of this stuff. But notice we have a Nix tab here on the left now, mm-hmm. just underneath details, so you can click on that and we know about what Nix we've provided and so on. If you go to the shell that we have.
The shell? Oh, my shell?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's have a look in those two directories again. So, there we go. So, firstly, what's happened in boot is that Foreman has gone out to the TFTP proxy for the provisioning Nix, as we discussed, and said, by the way, I totally need you to get me this init ID and this kernel. And if the proxy has them, great. And literally, it's doing a size zero check, right? If you have any file with the correct file name,
yep.
then it won't touch it. So you can override those with other ones if you need custom ones, and the proxy won't change them, right? Mm. If they're broken or you need a newer one or whatever, right? But if there's no file there, the proxy will go and get it from the mirror.
Okay.
Which in your case was super fast because there's a Katello mirror that's right there on the box.
Yep.
And then if we cat the, not the .ipixie file, but the plain one in Pixie Linux, .cfg. And for those people who are watching the video, this is where you pause it and go back to when we were looking at the templates like 20 minutes ago. Cat that.
And which this
that
one?
Yeah, that one.
Okay.
Boom. So we have a perfectly valid Pixie Linux file with... What have we got here? We've got the correct VM liners. We can see that in the directory up above. We've got the correct init ID. We've got Foreman URL. And you can see we've got a token. if we go back and a boot interface and a whole bunch of other parameters, right? But the token's the key bit. Go back to the UI.
Okay. And that one.
And go to the properties front. Don't want to be on next just now. If you click on properties,
there we are.
That's great. You can see the tokens there. It's the fourth item in the table. Tokens are only valid for a short period of time. Default is 60 minutes. And that's to stop abuse of the system, right? Because potentially now anybody could boot a machine with that token and get this machine's kickstart and therefore any secrets associated with it.
So is this different than the Puppet?
Yeah, it's a completely Foreman-only thing.
Oh, okay.
It has no other, it's stored in the database. It has no other value other than for provisioning. And after 60 minutes, it will time out and be deleted from the database, at which point the machine won't be able to be built anymore. And you, but the way to cycle it is if you go to the top, you can click Cancel Build.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. Now, go back to your shell and have a look at that file again. So it will still be there. Unlike before, we created the host where there were no files in that directory. The file will still be there now, but it will say local boot instead.
And it does.
So this is how Foreman manages hosts. This is how discovery works. This is how we tell the difference between a host that Foreman knows about and a host that Foreman doesn't know about at the booting level, right? Because if the file exists, it means Foreman's written it. And therefore, we know about the host, right? And it will boot to local boot. And with discovery, what happens is that file marked default, which is the third item in your directory listing, that one will also say local boot right now if you count that one.
Sorry, the third one in my directory
list? Yeah, you can see there's two that have got the 12s in, and there's one called default. So if you count the default.
Okay, yeah. Oops. At pixie config default.
Right, this is also local boot, right? But you've got discovery here as well, and you can, you're, right at the top it says on timeout local. So at the moment, discovery is a manual process.
Yeah.
But ultimately, the workflow of discovery is you change that to be on default discovery, and then any machine Foreman's never seen before, you plug it in, turn it on, you don't care after that, because it's going to boot discovery automatically and report all its data to Foreman, at which point the MAC address is now known to Foreman, and you can provision that host directly from Foreman without ever having to write the MAC address down.
Right, and in order to make discovery the default, you have to put discovery into the config.
So there's two ways you can do it. You can just change this file if you want. Foreman doesn't touch it unless you tell it to.
Okay.
But you can edit the template as well. So if you go to configure templates.
Oh, is it there?
No, sorry.
I thought it was. Is it host? Okay.
I'm pretty sure. Oh, maybe they changed it. Maybe it's new. It used to be that you just edited the template and redeployed it.
Oh, okay.
They may have made it like a global setting by now.
Yeah.
Which would be smarter, to be honest. I tend to write
provisioning.
And other people make them nice. You have discovery over there as well, if that's.
I think this is it here.
Oh yeah, look at that. Nice.
Yeah. Okay.
See, that's new. I didn't know about that. I bet you Lukas is going to watch this right in 2 days and tell me that's been there for like 2 years. But hey, I wrote discovery like 6 years ago, so
there you go.
So fair play. Anyway, that's the basic workflow of discovery, right? You change what happens with default, and then if the file doesn't exist, Foreman can treat it as a freshly discovered host and bring it up into the RAM disk.
Mm-hmm.
And if the MAC address is there, then Foreman already knows about it, and either it's meant to be being built or it's not, and therefore the file will tell it what to do, right?
Gotcha.
And so that's what stops it becoming a discovered host after you've provisioned it. It's because it's got a specific file to its MAC address saying you need to local boot.
Makes sense.
And this means you don't have to go back into the BIOS and change them to not boot off the network. You can leave them as network booting. In fact, you want to do that because obviously you'll want to be able to potentially reinstall them in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we don't have a lot of time left. So one last thing I wanted to talk about real quick was about Puppet. Now, let's do something real quick. Go back to your shell. Let's see if we can actually get a Puppet class applied and a report in on your Foreman host before we wrap up. So if you could just do Puppet module. Oh, I'm going to find a good one. Let's see. Puppet forge NTP. Just run that and it'll give you some help. No, not NTP. Delete the NTP. And just run that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it should tell you how. No, okay. Puppet help module, fine. I don't like the way they put help at the beginning. It's really annoying.
Yeah, I always find that weird when they do that. Okay.
Talking to me right now. Someone is talking to me at the moment. Oh, John's talking to me. He wants me to change the name of the video. Fair enough.
what are we changing it to?
Something else, but very similar.
Okay.
So where did we get up to? Yes. Okay. So so you can see the environment defaults to production, which is what we already talked about. Module path should be fine. So let's just do puppet module install, and then as one string, puppet lab / ntp.
Is it that? No, it's not. No, puppet labs.
So you get these slash.
Slash?
Not dash, slash. Yes. You get these from the forge, right? So if you do that, it should go ahead and install them. So you can see where it's installing it, etc puppet labs code, blah, blah, blah. Now, if you go back to Foreman.
And I went to the wrong window.
We'll do it. 8 years. Yeah. We'll do it. It's fine. Go to configure. And then classes and import.
And so anytime you install a new class, you have to do this, right?
Or if you change them. What's important is not the code. If you're familiar with Puppet, you'll know there's a distinction between the class headers and the Puppet code, right?
Yes.
So in the class headers, you declare the class parameters and all that kind of thing. If those change, or if you're adding or removing classes, go and rescan. If you're changing the code but not the header, you don't need to tell Foreman. Foreman does not store the code.
Got it.
Anyway, import that, and I'll tell you about another gotcha that everyone falls over as well. Foreman doesn't import defines. I'll explain why in a moment. But if all you've got I get people all the time going, "Hey, I imported this module, and only half of the classes have shown up in Foreman," and I'm like, "Are they defines?"
Okay.
And the reason is ENCs, external node classifiers, which is what Foreman is to Puppet, can't declare defines. Defines are something you can have more than one of, right? And they have to be something you use inside your Puppet code. You say Apache vhost A, Apache vhost B, Apache vhost C, right? Where Apache vhost is a define. But you can only have one Apache class, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're singular. And so Foreman can't declare those. It's not allowed by Puppet's language to tell Puppet about defines within what it sends to Puppet. And so there's no reason for us to import it because we can't use them anyway.
I see.
And so you watch out for that one. Anyway, we have classes. Great. Go to your Foreman host. Let's apply a class and have a look at a report. And then I think we'll be done for the night, I think.
Okay.
Or for the afternoon, in our case.
Which one do you want to do?
No, Foreman host, because we haven't built the other one.
No, that's true.
You should definitely go and boot that thing up and give it the real MAC address and see if it works when we're done here.
Yeah.
We know how you get on. But edit that. Go to the Puppet classes, apply the class.
I assume you just take this one,
that's fine. Again, there's ways to filter like what gets imported by Foreman. So if you don't see all the config install service classes, you can tell it not to import those.
Okay.
It's actually a text file. You can't do it in the UI because you have to tell the proxy that you don't want it. Actually, no, it's in Foreman itself. Interesting. Anyway, there are plans to make that better, but there's plans for a lot of things.
Okay.
So submit that, and then I'm going to show you a bit I promised you about 20 minutes ago, which is where is the edge? Where is the definition line between Foreman and Puppet? So there's a button there marked YAML. Click on that. Mm-hmm. Boom. This is what Foreman sends to Puppet.
Okay.
Absolutely verbatim. You can see it's not styled. It's actually not quite the same API endpoint. But basically, this raw text, this YAML, is what Puppet gets. So what happens is, I might as well show you. Scroll down a bit before we leave this page. You can see at the bottom, we've got classes NTP, which we just added, and which environment it's in. And then the rest of it is parameters. And that's all an ENC can define. A list of parameters, a list of classes, and a list of environments. Oh, sorry, one environment, singular. That's it. That's what Puppet wants, right? Now, go to the shell, and I'll show you the other side of this equation. So if you cat the Puppet configuration file, which I believe is in etc puppet labs puppet.conf.
Labs puppet. Which one, sorry? Puppet.conf?
Okay, so under master, there's a couple of things to note here, but the first one we're going to look at is external nodes. Mm-hmm. So you can actually run this. So if you run that.
Okay.
Now, don't
do that. Oh, silly. Right there.
Right. That won't do anything by itself. You have to give the name of the host. So whatever name it is in Foreman, put that as the argument. So Foreman dot whatever.
Foreman dot
fully qualified. Yeah. Right. Boom, exactly the same YAML, right? So what are we seeing here? In the Puppet configuration, we have a parameter called external nodes. That is a script. It can be anything. You can write an external node classifier in 10 lines of bash. It will do the same thing to every single host, but you can write, so long as it outputs valid YAML that looks like that, it's fine. Puppet doesn't care. As long as it's executable and it outputs YAML, Puppet doesn't care. But all it has to do is take in a certificate and produce YAML. Right. So we have our own. We deploy it. It's one of the many things the installer does is to deploy that script and tell Puppet that it's supposed to call it. And it speaks to Foreman and gets that YAML. That's the line. If the problem is to do with what Puppet is doing with the YAML, as in there's duplicate definitions in your classes, or it's not acting the way you expect, the problem is with Puppet. If the problem can be seen in the YAML, then it's probably to do with how Foreman is generating the YAML.
Okay. So I'm going to just pause here for a second. This is another thing that I think other beginners like me would probably find helpful, is that this clear delineation between what is Foreman and what is Puppet is really helpful to me right now, because I was looking at it going, well, do I manage Puppet in here? Where do I do that? So now at this point, I know I manage Puppet completely separately, and I'm using Foreman simply to supply parameters for the ENC bit for Puppet to consume.
That's true. However, you can manage Puppet from it, because obviously you can have Puppet code that manages Puppet, right? In fact, we have a bunch of modules to do exactly that. They're in the installer. That's how we set it up. You can import them into your infrastructure and run them on a regular basis. I would highly encourage at least using the Puppet agent class to make sure that your Puppet agent is running on all your hosts.
Right, but I guess what I'm saying is that, like, as you were saying before, we don't import Puppet code into Foreman.
Right, exactly so.
So, yeah. So it's Foreman informing Puppet about what it needs to do.
That's right.
I don't know. That's not the right language, but anyway.
It's called an ENC if you're searching in the internet. ENC, External Node Classifier. And there are some gotchas. I highly recommend you popping that into Puppet's site search. There is a nice little page of gotchas about ENCs, about what you can and can't do. For example, you can mix it with a site.pp, but you have to be very careful how you do that.
Okay.
In particular, the most common one is where people have got a site.pp where not every node is specified. And when you start using an ENC, you can't do that. You have to have at least a default, like, don't do anything for like wildcard entry in your site.pp. Otherwise, the Puppet will abort, and everyone goes, Foreman wrote my Puppet. I'm like, no, it didn't. But anyway, yes, that's true. Anyway, give us a Puppet agent minus TV.
Puppet agent minus TV.
You have space in there. Puppet's like Git these days. It uses space separated argument.
Oh.
Boom, boom, boom. A whole bunch of facts coming out of stdlib, which was a dependency of NTP. Mm-hmm. So that'll take a sec. There we go. I'm going to load some facts. And with a bit of luck. Oh, the tension.
Mm-hmm. It's building.
Wow. Hopefully it's doing yum install NTP right now.
Oh, I meant the tension was building.
Oh, I see what you mean. Anyway, it looks like it's working. We'll see in a minute. But hopefully what we're going to do is going to go back to the UI and check.
There it goes.
Boom, we've got NTP. And that's now
running.
Now, if you go back to the UI, so the other thing that you'll see in that puppet.conf is that there's a reports equals Foreman, which, again, is a script that we provide that tells Puppet how to report to Foreman.
Okay. Do you want me to look at the reports?
Yes, please. Yes, please. There's a couple of ways we can look at this. So there you go. Four changes. Click on the 1 minute ago link. And so here we go, and you can scroll down, and somewhere down here there'll be a diff. Yeah, this is all the facts, so you only get this once, right? Yeah, this is once because of stdlib. If we stopped NTP and then ran it again, it started NTP, this would be like a one-line report, right? But click view diff.
Where am I looking for view diff?
Right on the line that you're highlighting on the right hand.
Oh, there it is.
Unlucky. There you go, a diff. More interestingly, if we go back a page, search in the go back a page. Here we to the report index. Here we go. Change that search entry to something like just put in a free text search of ntp.centos.org was it? URL. ntp.centos. Run that.
See what happens.
It should come up with the
Let's just see if I do. Nope.
All right. Well, let me teach you a little bit about the diff. Let me teach you.
Oh, sure. Sure.
Okay. So delete everything.
Yep.
In that field. And then just hit tab.
Okay.
404s? Weird. So what should happen is that this is a reasonably smart search system, which will provide you with a list of keys that you can search on.
Okay.
But for some reason, it's just not working today. So we could probably, we're out of time, but that would be a good time to go and show you how to dig in the production logs and see what that 404 is actually whinging about. Okay. However, I think at an hour and 20, we're probably running out of time. So a 10-minute wrap up there. First of all, are you happy with where we've got to? I'm assuming you've learned a fair amount.
Yeah, I have. For me, some of the really key takeaways here are where the boundary line is between Puppet and Foreman, that there you have to be really careful with your org and and location in order to make things work properly. And I think I get the provisioning process, even though we haven't yet done one. But
go and do it.
Well, I don't have a Mac handy. I don't want to waste your time.
Yeah, no. I don't mean now. I don't mean in the video, but I mean do it fairly soon. Put the real Mac in, plug a monitor in, check it's working. If it's not, let us know what's going on. But it looks like it ought to. The gotchas there are usually either that Pixie's not configured correctly, so it doesn't like it tries to Pixie, but XINetD doesn't respond. This is like the most horrible part, actually, and we couldn't test it. But usually something goes wrong in like getting that working. But if you've done Pixie before, you'll know a lot of the gotchas. So, for example, you know, if your DHCP server isn't handing back a correct next server IP and things like this. But they're all in one box, so it should work. Quite often when you start like spreading it out, it starts to break. But again, this is why having the proof of concept sandbox works really well, because you can look at one that works and go, what? So this is really helpful. I've enjoyed this immensely. Thank you so much for coming on and sort of being the guinea pig. It's not easy to sit there and just be like, I have no idea what I'm doing.
Do public humiliation. It's
well, great. I think that's more for us than for you, to be honest, because it's a reminder of just how bad some of our forms can be, right? But again, to reiterate, this is why we strongly emphasize the use of things like host groups, because you set that up once. And this is particularly good. It's not so much in your use case where you've got quite in your own ambition, a small infrastructure. But if you think about this from a sort of more enterprisey point of view, if you have a senior admin who gets it all up and running, and then you train the junior admins on what buttons to click, that becomes very powerful very quickly, right? Because because those, well, we didn't really go into like compute resources and things, but like that new host form changes very little when you look at a libvirt host to a bare metal host to a VMware host to an EC2 AWS host or whatever, right? Very little changes. And so it's very good from a training and consistency point of view.
Right.
So this is great once you start documenting things, right? Because you say, click on these things, it'll work. So great. In terms of next steps, obviously, check your provisioning's working. Have a play with SCAP. You should be able to do that on your Foreman host, I think, because it does its job through Puppet, so you can apply the appropriate Puppet classes now.
Okay, and as we said, there's no problem with me bringing that Foreman host into my org and location and using Puppet to manage it.
I don't see a problem with that at all. Okay. Certainly, I mean, you can already manage it with Puppet. We've proven that. You just applied NTP.
Yeah.
In terms of hitting that manage host button and bringing like its DNS and DHCP and so on under control, you can if you want. As I agree that there is questionable value, but it certainly won't break anything.
Okay, good.
So if you want it from a I do that. Yeah. Because quite often my Foreman host will be a VM on the libvirt hypervisor, and I want it to know about all the hosts that it's managing, right? And so there's actually an extra step there, and we didn't really talk about that stuff. You can tell Foreman to go and discover, like, match, like if you've created a whole bunch of VMs manually and then imported them into Foreman, you can tell it to go back later and say, discover which of these are actually VMs I could manage directly.
Oh, interesting. And then
it's called associating the VMs, but you can basically tell it to look at the hypervisor and look at its own list of hosts and figure out which ones are the same, usually by MAC address.
So, I mean, there are some bootstrapping questions that I would love to ask, but I know this isn't the forum to do that now. So in terms of next questions again, or next steps for a new user, when you get to the point where you've got a fully functioning provisioning setup, but then you have questions about, well, how do I bootstrap this? Is the best place the support forum? Do you guys like IRC? What's the community preference?
We don't really mind. IRC has always been the best place to get a real-time chat, but obviously you have to be there when other people are. If you don't mind a slower discussion, the forum's absolutely fine for that.
Okay.
It really doesn't matter to us either way. As I say, the trick with asking questions in IRC is knowing when people are about. And the answer to that is European time and sort of East Coast American time are the best sort of working hours.
Okay.
Because our developers, obviously, I'm generalizing here because we obviously have an active community as well. But in terms of who contributes the largest amount of code, the people who do that, not just Red Hatters, but the people in general who do that are split between India. So you can get fairly early in the day if you're super early. Then Israel, Central Europe, a few of us. I'm the only one in the UK at the moment, but I suppose I sit nicely in the middle. And then there's a whole bunch of people in North Carolina. Thanks, guys.
Okay.
And then, you know, various people. Actually, he doesn't work on Foreman anymore, but until quite recently, one of our the person who maintained the smart proxy actually lives in Vancouver. So,
cool.
That's
pretty close to here.
Lovely city as well. He sadly left the team later last year. So
okay.
To go back to your question, no, either is fine. You just have to get lucky with IRC and persevere if you really want that real time chat. Otherwise, the forum's fine, and hopefully people get back to you. The biggest problem with the forum is just there's so much. Be sure to tag your posts appropriately. That really helps because people follow tags. By tags.
Okay.
And so there should be Katello tags, provisioning tags, Ansible tags, and so on, right? That should help. You can also notify groups. People don't know they can do that, but if you do at Katello, for example, then everyone in Katello will get a ping.
Oh, okay.
And there's a variety of groups. If you head over to the forum and check the groups, there's a whole bunch of groups. And if you're interested in helping out in a particular group, they are self-sign up. So
you can
get notifications if you know a bit about a particular topic. This has worked quite well for things like VMware, which is quite popular, but we don't really have a lot of ways to test it. So actually the community does most of the testing for that.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, so Greg, I really appreciate you taking the time. This has been very helpful. And I hear that you're leaving your role, and I just wanted to say thanks for everything you've put in so far, and hope it goes well for you at whatever you're heading into.
I'm not going very far. I'm staying within Red Hat, so I will still be around, but just less visibly.
Got it.
But those kind words. Thank you. But you know, I didn't write Foreman, right? I joined about 2 years into Foreman's history. There were only six of us at Red Hat then doing
Foreman. Wow.
And a pretty active community. I was hired from the community. Life has changed somewhat. We're a much, much bigger project now, but always my goal has been to get a lively and self-supporting community. And it feels like we finally kind of started to achieve that, which is lovely.
Fantastic. So,
again, thank you to you and the others in the Getting Started thread that have been helping each other out and sharing your experiences, because it's really great to see. Okay.
Awesome.
Well, pretty much bang on the 90-minute mark. I think that's
all right.
A really good time to wrap up. I'd like to say thanks also to John and Partha for joining in, helping us with the Katello side of things, which is, as many people know, not my strong suit, to my eternal shame, since, you know, Red Hat paid my time. But like, you got to pick and choose, right? So I'll just flip back to the front page just to wrap it up, I guess. What have I done with that? Oh, there it is. Found it. Too many tabs. Too many desktops. I use i3. I've got like 10 desktops. Right. Here we go. Let's flip back to that. So yes, hopefully other people find this useful. If you have questions that come up out of this, or you have trouble following some of the discussion that we've had, do reach out to us. You can reach us on the forum or on IRC as just discussed. Until then, thank you all for joining us. I hope you have a great evening, and I will see you again on Thursday, actually, because we have a community demo on Thursday. Until then, take care.
Great.